The Affluent Society, 1953 to 1960, Chapter 24. We're almost there, folks. I know it sounds silly to you young people because it seems like so long ago for you, but it was called the Golden Age of Capitalism. Stable prices, low unemployment, right after the war. During the war, of course, everything was rationed and you couldn't spend any money, so there was a lot of money to be spent as soon as they raised the limits or got rid of those restrictions. The standard of living was going up and up and up. Well, that is if you were white middle class. And most Americans were considered middle class, and we had things we'd never had before. We had televisions. You sometimes had more than one. You had air conditioners, not just in the movie houses now. It was in your home. Dishwashers, and we used up to pay for each phone call we made, so we all of a sudden started having cheap long-distance phone bills and jet travel and an airplane. All of that was just unbelievable. Most everyone had electricity and indoor plumbing. It was very common. Although I must admit that my mother-in-law didn't have electricity and running water in her house until the late 1950s, because she lived outside of town. She lived in the county. Japan and Europe were recovering from the war, and we had become the world's industrial superpower. Our automobile craft factories, our steel factories, our aircraft industry, they dominated the world. In the South, it was mostly military bases and shipyards, primarily because of the weather. And in the West, it was a military technological production, like Silicon Valley. In New England, they had the aircraft and submarine production. But even with all this going on, the economy is moving toward more service industry. And industry is starting to turn to mechanization to reduce costs. The number of farms decline. More and more people are moving to the cities. Now, the Southern agriculture reduced the number of needed workers by going with a little bit of industrialization. And 3 million African Americans and whites left the South, going north to find industrial jobs. But housing construction, and even nowadays we use housing starts as a method to measure how well the economy is doing. Consumer goods and purchases are causing the economic growth in our country like you would not believe. Now, because there were so many young people who had left the service and they wanted to own their own homes, they had to start building homes because there wasn't enough homes in the towns. So they built little subdivisions. Cheap houses. And of course, the number of homeowners doubled because the military, the ex-military, had what they call the GI Bill, which we learned about last time, that you could get a house cheap. And all of a sudden, all these homes were centered around the mall because you had all these houses, you had to have someplace to go shopping. And you had to have appliances and TVs and cars and this little YouTube, believe it or not, I think it was probably made in the 50s if you want to know the truth, but it pretty much shows you the way things were growing. And it's Levittown is in New York, of course. It used to be a potato field. Come on, YouTube, let's go. There we go. Well, they haven't gotten any quicker, have they? I hope all that rain this morning didn't do something. There we go. Took almost as long to bring it up as it's going to be to see it. Okay, I'm just going to tell you what's on it. It's during this time of building for Levittown that we started doing a kind of a, oh, what do they call it? You're all working in a factory and you stay at the one place and do the same thing all the time and start building houses like that too. Oh, where's my PowerPoint? There you are. And they would build several of them at one time and they go through and lay all the foundation. They go through and lay all the studs and they go through and all the roofs on. So everybody was doing the same thing at the same time. So you had carpenters working all the way through. Then you had all the electricians going through. And it went really, really fast. And, of course, once you've got all these people, you've got to have someplace for them to shop. So they began to be around a mall, as they say. We had schools and public pools. And you had stores like Woolworths and JCPenney's and banks, all for the convenience of the people living in these subdivisions. But unlike eastern cities, California, everything revolved around a car. You drove to work, you drove to shop. I lived in California for 3 years, and I hated every minute of it. It was just, nobody was too friendly. You lived in a mall, and you had to drive everywhere, and this is what traffic was like in the 50s, so you can imagine what it's like now. But we all gladly accumulated debt in order to maintain our consumer lifestyle. We owned TVs, and they all began to replace the newspapers. It was easier to get the news on the radio and television than it was reading it. TV programming, to avoid controversy, everything was very, I call it pablum, like Leave It to Beaver and Father Knows Best and I Love Lucy. Everything was humdrum, middle class. There wasn't any controversy. There wasn't any sex, nothing. But it also, one of the things bad about it was you had TV commercials and it's spreading the notion of consumerism, how you need to have this, you need to have that, not only with the commercials, but with the shows. And I don't know about you, but if you've ever seen Father Knows Best and Leave It to Beaver, the mother always has on high heels and hose and a nice pretty dress and pearls. And I don't know about you all, but when I clean house, I don't dress like that. The television became a babysitter. I noticed the round screen, and usually the picture was pretty green, if you want to know the truth. But the car. Buying a car was very essential because everyone had to have a car. And 4 out of 5 had at least one car because sometimes the mother was working. And if the dad was in town working and you're out in the subdivision, you have to take the kids to school. You have to take them to their ball practice. You have to take them to ballet lessons. So you need a car, too. So every family really needed two cars. And the auto manufacturing and oil companies became the top companies in the United States. Detroit industry alone employed over 40,000 employees to make cars. So you can see the car really transformed American life, not only getting us to and from places, but all the satellite industries like the drive-in movies and the gas stations and the drive-in places to get something to eat. You had to have a car to get there, too. See, here we go. You got McDonald's and drive-in theaters. Oh, the drive-in movies were something else. I don't think most young people ever watched the actual movie because you were in a car with the windows up, but some people did. So in the wartime, you had the lady wanting to go to work and do the man's job and help the economy. But in peacetime, they wanted the lady in the kitchen cooking and having babies. Well, not having babies in the kitchen, but this was her job. But the number of women working increased. And unfortunately, they weren't union jobs. They were low-paying jobs. And so the women worked not to help support the family, but to have money to purchase more consumer goods. And quite honestly, I went to work the first time to be able to afford to buy this big new television set we wanted that we couldn't afford on my husband's salary. Women were marrying younger and there was divorce was less, but there's more children. This is the baby boom from 1942 to 1965, I think it was. Yeah, from the end of the war to the mid-1960s. But women in home separated the free world from the communist world. And it was broadcast so many times because look at the Russian women. They have to go to work, but we only work because we wanted to. But even the ethnic Americans joined in this consumerism. But the suburbs were very much segregated. The government officials would issue mortgages based on only white. It was declared unconstitutional, and the banks did take over the loaning officials, but it still was segregated. 1949, the government built more than 1 million units, what they called public housing, low-income housing. But the urban renewal was demolishing poorer neighborhoods to develop shopping centers. So even though they were being built, they would be demolished almost as soon as they were built. So the whites that could moved to suburbs. And the only people who stayed in the city were the non-whites. They couldn't afford to move. Unfortunately, when the whites moved out of the city, a lot of the jobs moved too. 7 million whites moved to the suburbs between 50 and 70. And 3 million blacks moved from the south to the north to find work. 500,000 Puerto Ricans moved to the mainland. And as I said, the industrial jobs are moving out of the cities. So these areas of town become ghettos, become centers of crime. And the suburban whites thought non-whites in the neighborhood would lower property values. So they did everything they could to discourage anyone who wasn't white from living in their neighborhood. But when you look at it, all the problems seem to be solved. We all valued our individualism and we had respect for private property, and we thoroughly believed that there was equal opportunity out there. Religious differences were absorbed in the Judeo-Christian heritage. For the first time, you begin to hear people not say, if you weren't a Methodist, you're going to hell. If you weren't a Baptist, you're going to hell. If you weren't Jewish, you were going to hell. Everybody was pretty staunch in their religion, and in the 50s, it started melding a little bit. But the majority of American churchgoers were not necessarily there for religion. Group assimilation, and much like it is here in the Holy City, we go to be seen in church. Free enterprise, economic system based on private ownership, and it seemed to unite the nations of the free world. Selling of this idea became major industry because advertising, school programs, newspaper editorials, and civic activities, they all ignored how the government policies had really spurred all this post-war economic growth, plus the fact of all the money we'd held back because we couldn't spend during the war. But freedom became defined as freedom of choice for the consumer. So we have a man named Milton Friedman who asked the question, has America become a classless society? Has affluence made poverty a relic of history? And some people are trying to revive conservatism. Is it going to work? He wanted free government market with no government regulations whatsoever. He wanted to repeal the minimum wage, the federal law. He wanted a graduated income tax and social securities. Well, I can see some of it. Others wanted a civilization based on Christian values. Now, if you were Christian, that was great, but what if you were Mohammed, you were Islam, or you were Jewish? All individuals should be responsible for their own actions. Well, I'm not going to go along with that. But the government could force you to obey if you didn't. If you weren't a good citizen, the government could come in and make you be a good citizen. Now, wait a minute. That sounds like Big Brother, doesn't it? But both sides agreed that a united front against the Soviet bloc meant big government. Dwight David Eisenhower, the man who won the war for us in Europe, he ran for office mainly to keep Senator Taft out because he didn't like the way Taft was talking. He chose as his running mate a man named Richard Nixon of California. Nixon was a member of the House Un-American Activities Committee. He was seeing communists everywhere you looked. He was a senator from California, but he had a reputation for being opportunist and a little bit dishonest. He was a skillful politician. Oh, he was a good man. 52 presidential campaign was the first time television was used, and I pledged to bring peace in Korea because we were at that time fighting the Korean War. The Republicans did not gain control of Congress even though they had a Republican president. In 1954, the Democrats gained solid control of both houses. Winston Churchill is again prime minister in England, and Charles de Gaulle becomes prime minister in France. So we've got a Republican president, and businesses are influenced in everything that's going on in District of Columbia. I did reduce spending, and he cut the military budget, and I remember my father was so angry because he was a very staunch Democrat, and the only reason he even voted for Ike was because Ike was a military man, and he knew that Ike was going to do something for the former military. What did he do? He cut the military budget. He did not roll back the New Deal programs. He even expanded some of them into what he called modern republicanism. Meanwhile, Britain and France are expanding the welfare state and nationalizing their key industries. But U.S. leaves the major industries in this country in private hands. But government spending and this new highway system employed or thought of by Ike and introduced was really boosted the employment. That's what it is. I call it the Eisenhower Highway System. And although I don't think y'all are familiar with it out here, he got the idea when he was in Germany during the war. He saw the Autobahn and how big it was, and he thought it was a great idea. It's been called the greatest public works project in history. And every citizen has been touched by it, and if not directly as motorists, then probably because they helped build it and buy things from it. President Eisenhower considered it one of the most important achievements of his two terms in office, and historians agree. Now, he did not build this highway system to help you get from the suburbs to town. He was thinking about World War III, and he wanted a public system that you could move the military rapidly. You can move the military rapidly over these big highways, and you can also land planes on them if you can't get to the airport. He was thinking about protection of the country. 1947, something called the Taft-Hartley Act is produced, and it reduces labor mobility because in 1955, AFL and CIO get together and become one big labor union. But the new methods leave major decisions to the managers, and the union people promise not to have wildcat strikes. And in return, the company accepts the wages and increases their wanting and some of the benefits, as long as they promise not to strike. So union employees prosper. Union did not. If you were non-union, you didn't have the same benefits. Of course, if you were union, you had insurance and you had retirement. But if you were non-union, you got a paycheck when you got on paydays, and that was about it. But I did blend in the Korean War. But what we call the Cold War tensions are going to increase, and we explode a hydrogen bomb. Next year, the Soviets have the hydrogen bomb. So both nations begin to build bombers to carry these big bombs. Now, I hated the war. The Secretary of State, John F. Douglas, was the opposite. He figured, much like some of our other presidents, like Teddy Roosevelt, a little war now and then helped people along. But Douglas kind of went along. He kind of liked war. But in 54, Dulles updates the containment theory of President Truman. It was said there would be a massive retaliation on any nation that was attacked by the Soviets. Now, think that again. Be a massive attack by us, the United States, on any nation that was attacked by the Soviet Union. Crazy, isn't it? He reduces conventional military spending and begins focusing on nuclear weapons and the size of military drops. At this point in time in history, both Russia and the United States were quite capable of destroying each other. And I hopefully think that it was because of this that they decided to be a little cautious. But meanwhile, the government builds public bomb shelters, and we have school drills to what to do in case of war and bombs. And this little film is one that we all saw in the 40s and 50s. It was made back in those days, but don't laugh. We believe this. Oh, come on.
Dum dum, little dum dum, little dum dum, little. Dum dum, there was a turtle by the name of Bert. And Bert the turtle was very alert, and danger threatened him, he never got hurt. He knew just what to do. He's duck and cover, duck and cover.
He did what we all must learn to do.
You and you
and you
and you. Duck and cover.
Be sure and remember what Bert the Turtle just did, friends, because every one of us must remember to do the same thing. That's what this film is all about. Duck and cover.
This is an official civil defense film produced in cooperation with the Federal Civil Defense Administration and in consultation with the Safety Commission of the National Education Association. Produced by Archer Productions, Incorporated.
Hey, Bert, come on out and meet all these nice people, please. Oh, all right. We really can't blame you. You see, Bert is a very, very careful fellow. When there's danger, this is the way he keeps from being hurt. Sometimes it even saves his life. That's why these children are practicing to duck and cover just as you do in your school. We all know the atomic bomb is very dangerous. Since it may be used against us, we must get ready for it. Just as we are ready for many other dangers that are around us all the time. First, you'll have to know what happens when an atomic bomb explodes. You'll know when it comes. We hope it never comes, but we must get ready. It looks something like this. There is a bright flash, brighter than the sun, brighter than anything you've ever seen. If you were not ready and did not know what to do, it could hurt you in different ways. It could knock you down hard or throw you against a tree or a wall. It is such a big explosion, it can smash in buildings and knock signboards over and break windows all over town. But if you duck and cover, like Bert, you will be much safer. You know how bad sunburn can feel. The atomic bomb flash could burn you worse than a terrible sunburn, especially where you're not covered. Now, you and I don't have shells to crawl into like Bert the Turtle, so we have to cover up in our own way. First, you duck, and then you cover. And very tightly, you cover the back of your neck, your face. Duck and cover underneath a table or desk or anything else close by. In Betty's school, they are talking about the atomic bomb, too. Betty is asking her teacher, how can we tell when the atomic bomb may explode? And her teacher is explaining that there are two kinds of attack, with warning and without any warning. We think that most of the time we will be warned before the bomb explodes, so there will be time for us to get into our homes, schools, or some other safe place. Our civil defense workers, our men in uniform will do everything they can to warn us before enemy planes can bring a bomb near us. You may be in your schoolyard playing when the signal comes. That signal means to stop whatever you are doing and get to the nearest safe place fast. Always remember, a flash of an atomic bomb can come at any time, no matter where you may be. Here are some older boys showing what to do if the flash comes when you are not in the classroom. This is what to do if you should be in a corridor. You duck and cover tight against the wall this way. Remember to keep your face and the back of your neck covered tightly. Try to fall away from windows or doors with glass in them. Then, if the glass breaks and flies through the air, it won't cut you. You might be eating your lunch when the flash comes. Duck and cover under the table. Then, if the explosion makes anything in the room fall down, it can't fall on you. We must know how to duck and cover in the school bus or in any other bus or streetcar. Duck and cover. Don't wait. Duck away from the windows fast. The glass may break and fly through the air and cut you. If you do not know just what to do, ask your teacher when this film is over. Discuss what you could do in different places if a bomb explodes.
Remember what to do, friends. Now tell me right out loud. What are you supposed to do when you see the flash?
Duck and cover. Duck and cover. Duck and cover.
What could I say? Yes, it was propaganda. And yes, that was an actual film, as I said, and we saw it. And yeah, the sad thing is I think that the scientists and the higher-ups knew what would happen in an atomic explosion because they saw what happened in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. But this was probably to give us a little protection, damn little, and to give us a sense of that we could do something about it. But folks, if you're close enough to see the flash of an atomic explosion, ducking and covering isn't going to help you. Just bend over and kiss your rear end goodbye, because you're not going to be around very long, or if you are, you're going to hope you don't, because you're going to be burned with radiation. Hope to God we never have anything like that. But we were building bomb shelters in the backyard. Later on, they're going to be converted to storm shelters, but right now, there's a bunch of them still out there. Meanwhile, Joseph Stalin died in Russia. We have a new leader in Russia called Nikita Khrushchev. And he starts talking about Stalin crimes. He wanted to de-Stalinize things. He wanted things to be better. He came and visited the United States. And he looks like a lovely grandfather, doesn't he? A kind of a reform communism is what he was going to do. But unfortunately, it was because of him that we had the Cuban Missile Crisis and the Berlin Wall. So was there a thaw in the Cold War? A little bit, but not much. Khrushchev is calling for peaceful coexistence. Meanwhile, the Soviet troops go into Hungary and suppress a revolt, and our president did nothing. In 1958, Russia and the U.S. agreed to halt nuclear weapons tests in the air. But in 1959, Khrushchev tours the United States. He goes out and visits Disneyland, and everybody thinks he's great, a little smiling granddad. But a year later, the Soviets shot down a U.S. spy plane. Oh, yes, we had spy planes. They were the gliders, so they couldn't be picked up on radar. And as a matter of fact, that's as close as I ever came to meeting anybody famous, because I was working in Albany, Georgia at the time. And all of a sudden, these guys come to the front door of our building, and you could tell there was something about these guys. I mean, they had tight blue suits on with a little bit of a bulge under their left arm, and they wore sunglasses and cut hair cut real short. I mean, they just looked dead ringers, sort of FBI agents, right? So they talk to the president, and all of a sudden, they take one of the workers and leave. But we didn't find out for a couple of days. What had happened is the man who had been shot down in this spy plane was Francis Gary Powers, and his brother was working at the same place I was. But they were out trying to round up all of his family so that the Russians couldn't say, we've got your family, you've got to tell us all this information. It was quite a day, I'll tell you. Most excitement I think I've ever had. But what about the third world countries? And what do we call a third world country? It's one who's, they're just beginning to develop and get industrialized. And a lot of them didn't want to be friends with us or Russia. But no matter how you look at it, they're going to be affected by the Cold War. And Europe's hold on the empires is beginning to crumble. There's decolonization in Asia and Africa. Then India and Pakistan gain independence in 1947. In late 1950s, Guyana, Indonesia, Malaysia, Nigeria, and Kenya become new nations in Africa. But we're beginning to feel communist influence or some form of socialism. And, you know, these new nations, they're young and they're apt to be persuaded. They're not aligned with us, but they do admire us. Meanwhile, a man named Ho Chi Minh becomes Vietnam's leader. So containment, or financial, in the third world countries. Guatemala, land reforms threaten the United Fruit Company owned by the United States. Iran, and nationalized the Anglo-Iranian oil company. And of course, we branded all these people as communists. In 53 and 54, the CIA, our CIA, orchestrated some coups. In 1956, Egypt nationalized the Suez Canal. England, Israel, and France invaded Egypt. Well, this is something I didn't want. He didn't want a war with all the Arabian nations. He forced them to abandon the invasion, but Egypt said, you know, it's on our land. We need to be able to control the Suez Canal. But we're now the dominant Western power in the Middle East. In 57, Ike extends containment policy to the Middle East and issues what he calls the Eisenhower Doctrine. And he commits the United States to defend the Middle Eastern governments that were friends of ours. Back in 45, France had attempted to crush Ho Chi Minh, but the anti-communists pulled the U.S. into involvement. Ike gives billions of aid to the French, not people, but money. 1954, it's obvious that the French are still losing. Ike did not send troops, but we sent advisors. And he was advised to use nuclear weapons by our National Security Council. France finally concedes Vietnamese independence, and Vietnam is divided, north and south. Well, the South refuses elections. The South's leader is Catholic. He tried to, he was trying to be better than he is. He liked the rich farmers. He didn't like the small farmers. He didn't like the Buddhists either. So very shortly, he's facing a guerrilla war by the communists from North Korea. North Vietnam, I'm sorry. The U.S. begins intervening. We allies with the southern regime. It's not democratic, but we'll be friends with as long as you're not communist. Meanwhile, the Shah in Iran is replaced by the radical Islamic government, Ayatollah Khomeini. Vietnam is going to become the most disastrous war in our history. McCarthyism makes criticism disloyal. And some believe that the Cold War is occurring, obscuring the United States' idea of freedom. Some believe American conformists can't even think independently. So we've started having a lot of dissension in our troops. All the camaraderie and the loyalty and everything we felt in the 40s and the 50s is kind of coming unglued. We don't understand some of these people that our country is being friends with. We don't understand what is this thing in Vietnam about. Even the gentlemen who were fighting didn't know why they were there. John Kenneth Galbraith, an economist and author of The Influence Society, begins to worry that we're neglecting some important things. We're neglecting our schools and our parks and our public service. We're just neglecting everything to satisfy the public's consumer desires. And some began to criticize the modern work, the suburban life, and the influence of advertising. You know, advertising was everywhere. But it didn't change any of the 1950s lifestyle, and nobody altered any alternative. So who are we going to blame all this on? Well, we're blaming it all on the communists, and we're even starting to say that the young people, young teenagers, they're beginning to be alienated, and we write books about it. The teens are wearing leather jackets. They're dancing to something called rock and roll, and listen and dance to black musicians, and then somebody called Elvis Presley comes along. And I think this is a little bit about the rock and roll and Elvis Presley.
One, two, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock.
Oh, come on.
Rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're going to rock around the clock tonight. Put your bad bags on. Join me, home. We'll have some fun when the clock strikes one. We're going to rock around the clock tonight. We're going to rock, 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 rock.
Well, that'll be the day when you say goodbye. Yes, that'll be the day when you make me cry. You say you're gonna leave. You know it's a lie, 'cause that'll be the day when I die. Well, you give me all your love.
They're really rocking in Boston and Pittsburgh, PA. Deep in the heart of Texas. And on the Crystal Bay, all over the St. Louis, and down in New Orleans, all the cats gonna dance.
Sit home all alone. If you can't come around, off, at least please tell the phone. But don't be cruel to who heart is true. Baby, if I made you mad for something I might have said.
It's so easy to fall in love. It's so easy to fall in love. Tell me he loves for fools. So here I go, breaking all of the rules. It seems so easy.
It seems so easy. It seems so easy.
Oh, so doggone easy.
Doggone easy. Doggone easy.
It seems so easy.
It seems so easy. It seems so easy. It seems so easy.
Well, you're concerned in my heart.
It mambo rock. There's an island in the Caribbean Sea where the natives dance and a rock with glee. They mambo dance in a different way. They do the crazy mambo rock all day. Yep.
Let's rip it up.
Well, Saturday night, and I just got paid. Ain't about the money, don't try to save. My heart says go, go. Have a time for the Saturday night, and baby, I feel fine. I'm gonna rock it up. I'm gonna rip it up. I'm gonna shake it up. I'm gonna break it up. I'm gonna lock it up at the ball tonight.
I'm sure you all are not really enjoying that, but if you talk to your grandparents, I think you'll discover that that's the kind of music they grew up with. part of the problem was most of the white parents were raising so much cane about this music, mainly because, as you noticed, the first few songs that we played were all by African-American artists. And so that we were dancing to black music, and it was considered a disgrace. It was later 50s, early 60s, before we started seeing really a lot of white performers. And the adults, of course, you know, it's juvenile delinquency. And all of a sudden, believe it or not, in the 50s is when the Playboy magazine was debuted. The Beatles, they were in the 60s a little bit later on. But the Beats, it's a small group, very small group of poets and writers. Jack Kerouac, Allen Ginsberg, they were always writing books about what it was like to experience LSD and all the other good drugs. The Beats were a group of young people who did not like anything. They would get together in coffee houses and not take baths and not cut their hair, and they'd always wear black, and they would kind of say, like, my cat doesn't love me, and they'd snap their fingers, and crazy stuff. I never did get into that, thank heavens. I just didn't understand it. I'm ashamed to admit I really liked the 1950s music, and I'm not going to take the time to play these. You can if you would want to. It's basically Chubby Checkers and no Dick Clark dance band, rocking around the clock. I think I gave you enough rock and roll music from the 50s. But like the French Impressionist artists in Paris, the Beat writers were a small group of close friends first and a movement later. And here it goes into, they rejected the work ethic. They didn't want to work. They rejected middle-class materialism. They rejected the Cold War's militarization. They were for immediate gratification, using drugs and sexual experimentation. But meanwhile, we have something else going on, civil rights. And the movement came and caught us all by surprise. The black voters were a very large part of the Democratic coalition in the South. But the gap between the U.S. rhetoric and the realities of the situation, I mean, it wasn't a land of opportunities unless you were white, lost. The NAACP starts making strides using legalities and court cases. And the Southern black churches became the base, and they're going to be very prominent in the 60s. They organized something called nonviolence, led by a young gentleman named Reverend Martin Luther King. But the blacks are segregated, and they're losing their jobs more all the time, and they're living in poverty. Jim Crow was very popular in the South. It was a custom, not the laws that separated them. And Truman had tried to get a civil rights plan, but it was defeated by the Congress. I did not want to talk about race relations at all. He appoints Earl Warren, a former governor of California, to the Supreme Court in 1953. And Thurgood Marshall goes to court over the separate but equal doctrine from 1898, when you could have separate but equal. They had separate, but it was never equal. And some people in the South, especially the higher education, began to see the handwriting on the wall. May 17, 1954, the separate but equal rights law is struck down with a statement that segregation inflicts a lifelong damage on black children by undermining their self-esteem. Now, it did not outlaw segregation in any place other than in public schools. It didn't do it for private schools. And it did not immediately order immediate integration. But it did signal the leanings of the Earl Warren Court. And it gave hope to a lot of the people who were in the civil rights movement. School segregation banned. Oh, dear. I don't think we're going to have time for this. In August of 55, a 14-year-old black boy from Chicago whistled at a white woman at a grocery store in a place called Money, Mississippi. His name was Emmett Till. He didn't understand that he'd broken the unwritten laws or the Jim Crow laws until 3 days later, when two white men dragged him from his bed in the dead of night, beat him brutally, and then shot him in the head. And although his killers were arrested and charged with murder, they were both acquitted quickly by an all-white, all-male jury. Shortly after the trial was over, they sold their story, including a detailed account of how they had even murdered him, to a journalist. But the murder and the trial horrified the nation as a whole. And his death was a spark that helped mobilize the civil rights movement even more. 3 months after his body was pulled from the Tallahatchie River, the Montgomery bus boycott began. I would like for you to go on YouTube, if you think about it, and pull up the Emmett Till story. They've got several beautiful stories about it. It tells how his mother had him buried with an open casket in Chicago. It was bad. Rosa Parks, a quiet, educated, working woman, member of the NAACP, was arrested for not giving up her seat on a bus to the white people. And it sparked the Montgomery bus boycott. It was something that had been in the works for a long time. The people of the city, the young blacks, educated blacks, had been trying to find someone who could get arrested for these crazy laws of blacks and white not be able to mix on the bus, and blacks couldn't be able to sit beyond a certain point. They would stop the bus and throw you off. I mean, physically throw you off if you were black sitting in what they call the white section. They had several people arrested, but one was too old. There was a man who was an alcoholic, and the other was too young, and she'd been known to be a prostitute. But finally, they had a woman who was educated, a working woman, who didn't bother anybody, had no arrest record, Miss Rosa Parks, and she refused to give up her seat. Martin Luther King gets involved, and the South-wide nonviolent movement was launched by the black churches. We get more into that in the next chapter. But Martin Luther King appeals to the black sense of injustice, and he offered a philosophy of meet evil with good, hate with Christian love, and violence with peaceful demands. He also appealed to the white Americans to emphasize the blacks' loyalty to society. He forms a Southern Christian Leadership Conference in 1956, and the South refuses to accept the Brown decision. The federal government did nothing. Southern whites launched the resistance campaign, and they signed something called the Southern Manifesto, mostly Southern senators. And South begins to pass laws to block desegregation. It even outlaws the NAACP in some Southern states. And the federal government stays out of it. In 1957, LBJ, majority leader of the Senate, gets a law focusing on black voters, but it was a weak law and it wasn't enforced. I called Americans to obey the law. And he made it clear he did not welcome the civil rights legislation. Then they decided to send some black children to a white school in Arkansas. And the governor, Orville Faubus, used the National Guard to prevent the desegregation. Ike was put in a position he had to send in federal troops. But elsewhere, the government did nothing. This is also a very short film. I think I want you to see this because if nothing else, I want you to look at the faces of the white people who were against this.
moments, an event that forever altered the course of race relations in America. As our image reveals itself, the 1957 school year is about to begin, and an angry mob is trying to stop nine black students from entering Central High in Little Rock, Arkansas.
Question I usually get asked is, were we scared? I think initially, we didn't anticipate, clearly, all of the violence and turmoil that occurred. The first day that we attempted to go to school, eight of us were at one part of the school, and Elizabeth Eckman was at another part, and it was the mob that followed Elizabeth. Then you begin to feel that this was a very hostile, violent group of people. Even at that point, I told myself that if we didn't go through with it, didn't attend Central and backed out, it would just reinforce the view that the African-American community in Little Rock wasn't interested in making a change in things.
During the 1950s, African-Americans throughout the country were trying to make their voices heard.
We, the Negro citizens of Montgomery, Alabama, do now and will continue to carry on our mass protest.
The driver demanded that I give the seat up to a white man. I didn't feel that I was being treated as a human being. I refused to give up this seat. I said no.
Little Rock was a year after the Montgomery bus boycott. So we had seen the impact of Rosa Parks and the beginning of Dr. King's career, and knew that things could change.
All in favor, let it be known by standing on your feet.
The first step for the Little Rock Nine came in May 1954, when the U.S. Supreme Court issued its opinion in the landmark case, Brown versus the Topeka, Kansas Board of Education. Separate but equal was inherently unequal, and integration was now the law of the land. In 1957, this decision and the power of the federal government were tested in Little Rock, Arkansas.
We didn't, at the moment we were selected, have any idea it was going to be as difficult as it turned out to be.
In the face of protests at Central High School, the governor of Arkansas, Orville Faubus, calls out the National Guard. His official reasoning is to preserve the peace and prevent violence.
It clearly wasn't to protect us. It was to make a symbolic stand. It was to protect the way of life in the South, because they barred our entrance.
Hoping to throw open these school doors, President Dwight Eisenhower does the unprecedented. He calls in the 101st Airborne Division of the U.S. Army.
I think President Eisenhower wanted to show that the federal government was supreme in this, and they could have done what they needed to do with 100 troops. But 1,000 paratroopers was really meant to send a message.
Under the guard of the U.S. Army, the students are finally able to do something seemingly very simple, go to school. But it would not be easy for Ernest Green or his eight fellow black students.
School was like going to war every day. The walks from class to class were where, you know, you had a lot of harassment, a lot of physical violence.
But Ernest Green persevered, becoming the first black graduate of Central High School with the class of 1958. Green would eventually go on to a successful banking career and government service in the Carter administration. But in 1958, integration was not complete in Little Rock. The following year, Governor Faubus closed all public schools in Arkansas instead of complying with desegregation. Schools in Arkansas would not be fully integrated until 1972. Yet the world would always remember these nine students who, by claiming their place in the classroom, were claiming their place in history.
Attending Central was special in the sense that it was part of history. It was part of a change. This was reverberating all over the country, all over the world.
Ernest Green wasn't the only member of the Little Rock Nine to make a name for himself. What happened to the rest? Well, one's a magazine publisher, another a social worker. There's also a teacher, a realtor, two writers, an accountant, and a clinical psychologist. Seems they did pretty well, all things being equal. For the History Channel, I'm Mike Rowe.
It's not just in the school of the growing discontent of the African Americans. The ever-present fear of communism, the Cold War, and then this was only a minute and a half long. Probably take that long to even bring it up.
October the 4th, 1957, while the Americans were still finalizing their plans, Sputnik was launched.
Then its casing opened, the springs snapped, and the nose cone was pushed out of the way. A ball with four antennae emerged to go it alone in the darkness of space. And a radio began to send a signal back to Earth. Humanity had entered the space age.
I remember when it was launched, we were all terrified. If the Russians were that far ahead of us, if they could launch something into space, well, my goodness. What was next? Is it going to be like a Buck Rogers? Could they wage war from outer space? And I was thoroughly convinced that the children that were growing up at that time were going to wind up speaking Russian. My poor husband, bless his heart, I got hysterical. And it was just terrifying. Because like I said, it seemed like every time we turned around, things were coming apart that you'd known all your life. Riots, people being killed, the communists everywhere you look. Now the Russians are doing this, and it's just, what's going on? You just don't know. But nations around the world are watching the civil rights development and movement develop in the U.S. And in 1960, we had a presidential campaign, was the closest in U.S. history, with John F. Kennedy of Massachusetts versus Richard Nixon of California. Televised debates. First time our Kennedy, the Democratic candidate, was a Catholic, and that was going to cause some problems. As you can see, Kennedy was a young, good-looking man, and Nixon didn't. He always seemed to have a 5 o'clock shadow. So here's how they sound up. John F. Kennedy was a Catholic, a Massachusetts senator, a World War II hero and veteran. His father had been ambassador to Great Britain, and he promised he's going to keep his church out of politics, keep them separate. He had a young, beautiful wife and very young children. Where Mr. Nixon, the former vice president, a Protestant from California, member of the HUAC, the House Un-Americans Activities Committee, He always looked tired, and he always looked like he needed a shave. He wasn't as quick or as articulate as JFK, and his wife was quiet, not that pretty, and a little bit mousy. So when you compare the two of them, if you went by looks alone, JFK was a shoe-in. Those men happened to be ardent Cold War warriors. But Kennedy seemed like a breath of fresh air. He was young, he was energetic, he was good-looking. And, you know, we had visions of diapers hanging on the clothesline behind the White House because we had a young president. And prior to this, we had FDR, an old man who was crippled. And we had Truman, who was an old man. And then we had Eisenhower, who was an old man. And now we had this young, good-looking man, and it just seemed like the beginning of a new world, Camelot. He won by a narrow margin, and it was the black vote to put him in. Now, I had warned against a military buildup, but most Americans liked it because it meant jobs for them. So the beginning of the 1960s and 1950s seemed to be fading. Cars and chemicals were spoiling the environment, and people are getting cancer. Housewives are rebelling against living in the suburbia. Blacks are extremely impatient with the slow pace of racial progress and our involvement in Vietnam. And then the 1960s arrived. If I remember right, this is a John Green YouTube let me check and see. If it is, we're not going to watch it. You can go on YouTube and watch it. I'm pretty sure that's what it is. Because he has a rather irrelevant way of talking about things. Always the truth, though. I will give him that. Yeah, this is John Green. Yep. I would like for you all to watch it if you have time, but he just is going to review everything that we had been through. So the 60s have arrived, and that's what we're going to cover next week. We're just going to cover the one chapter, chapter 25. It's about the Civil Rights Movement, and you won't even have a long answer. You'll have a short quiz, and then you'll have your final exam. So I'll release it Sunday night. I promise I won't forget this time. It will be due, let's make it Friday noon, because Friday is considered the last day of the class, and I'd like to have time to grade them before I have to turn in grades in come Monday. So you'll be busy this week because you've got to finish up your research paper and you've got your normal stuff. But next week you just have the one chapter to read. It's going to be a short lecture too, as a matter of fact. That being said...